In 1788, 5 cows, 2 bulls, 29 sheep, 5 rabbits, and other assorted livestock were landed in Australia by the First Fleet. Of course, there were the uninvited passengers too, fleas, lice, and rats. But one special passenger was missing from the livestock consignment, the dung beetle. Because of this omission, an ecological imbalance was caused, which has lasted for nearly 2 centuries. This has left Australia with several pests and without the means to control them. To attempt to restore the balance, scientists have turned to Africa. Many kinds of cattle evolved in Africa, and along with them many types of dung beetles. Over millions of years, a balance has been established between them. The cattle drop dung, the beetles break up the dung pads and bury them as food for their young. The beetle research program in South Africa is the brainchild of Dr. George Bornemisza of the CSIRO's Division of Entomology.
Here in Africa, the large herds of herbivorous animals support an immensely rich dung beetle fauna. Through millions of years, dung beetles evolved among these herds of game to such diversity that south of the Sahara alone, over 1,800 species are already known to science. It was therefore obvious that our attention had to be focused on this vast continent and its beetles. The Division of Entomology of the CSIRO, in cooperation with the Plant Protection Research Institute of South Africa, established a station in Pretoria in September 1970 to serve as a base for a research project. We started our program by surveying various game parks of southern Africa. One of the many sanctuaries we visited was the Gorongosa National Park near Beira in Mozambique. One of the best ways to collect dung beetles is by trapping them in pitfall traps baited with pieces of intestines of smaller animals. Special attention is being paid to the droppings of buffaloes as the most comparable dung in shape, size, and consistency with that of domestic cattle. In my search for bovine dung beetles in Africa, the most spectacular beetle I have found so far was on Gorongosa Ranch in Mozambique. On this ranch, dung pets were exposed in a paddock to study the speed of dung burial, a crucial factor in the control of flies that breed in cattle dung. After 24 hours, hardly a trace of dung was left, only the churned soil with a few exit holes indicating that some of the beetles had already departed. All the beetles that have been collected were taken into our laboratories, sorted out and paired off for performance studies, and only the eggs of the most efficient species will get a flight ticket to Australia.
Because of quarantine considerations, adult beetles cannot be sent to Australia. Instead, after service sterilization in Africa, the eggs of selected beetles are consigned by air in specially designed containers. Through the approval of the quarantine authorities, strict measures are enforced to prevent the entry of any exotic parasites or diseases. The first generation of beetles bred from the imported eggs never leave the quarantine area, and eggs laid by these beetles have to pass through a highly effective surface sterilization process. Field releases of beetles are only made from later generations, mass bred from these first generation African species. The imported eggs must be provided with suitable breeding conditions. The dung beetle team set to work to roll handmade dung balls from local cattle dung. As egg consignments may number up to 1,500 or more, this can be a lengthy job. Cavities made in the balls provide a suitable breeding chamber for the beetle eggs. The balls are packed in sand inside their incubation tubes and sprayed with water to ensure they retain a sufficient level of moisture. Except for the eggs, all imported material is sterilized as a further precaution that nothing undesirable is introduced. From egg hatching to the emergence of the adult beetle may take between 4 and 8 weeks, depending on the beetle type. Mass breeding of selected beetle species takes place under laboratory conditions to produce sufficient numbers for release in the field. In the beetles so far introduced into Australia, two types of dung dispersal behaviour can be seen. The first can be illustrated by the tunnelling beetle. This builds its nest directly beneath the dung pad. In order to film nesting activity, an artificial soil profile has been prepared in a sandwich of two pieces of glass. The beetles work in mated pairs. With amazing vigour and determination, the female excavates tunnels in the soil, pushing the soil to the surface in front of her with a bulldozer action. She constructs the egg chambers, or brood balls, from dung material which has been pushed into the tunnels by the male. In warm soil, the beetles work rapidly, building a brood ball about every 2 hours. After egg laying, the female seals off the entrance to the ball. The larva hatches after about 3 days and starts feeding on the brood ball. It eats the solid dung material as it has a well-developed biting and chewing mouth. On the other hand, adaptation in the adult has produced highly specialized mouthparts which are only capable of sucking the liquid components of the dung. The young beetle passes through its pupal stage and after about 35 days emerges as a young adult to dig its way to the surface and migrate to new dung pads in the vicinity and begin the cycle again. The second type of dung dispersal behaviour is dung ball rolling. The ball-rolling beetles disperse the dung by breaking off fragments and forming them into balls. There isn't always honour among ball rollers, and beetles may sometimes vie for possession of a ball, but the rightful owner usually manages to beat off the intruder. With prodigious energy, the ball rollers go about their work, often moulding and manoeuvring lumps of dung far larger than themselves. At the chosen nesting site, the female climbs onto the ball and excavates a chamber. After a single egg has been laid, she seals off the cavity, raising a slight mound over the egg chamber. The ecological imbalance which resulted from the introduction of domestic livestock into Australia without suitable dung-bearing beetles was not relieved by the naturally occurring beetle species. These had adapted themselves to dispose of the smaller, drier droppings of animals such as kangaroos and other marsupials. The native beetles couldn't deal effectively with the larger and wetter dung pads from domestic livestock. This cattle dung is the chief breeding site for pest flies, the bushfly in temperate areas, and the buffalo fly in tropical areas. Studies carried out in temperature control insectaries have established that speed of dung burial by beetles is a critical factor in fly control. This time-lapse sequence, filmed over some 43 hours, shows the activities of beetles in breaking up and burying a dung pad alongside a control pad where beetles are absent. If beetles are sufficiently numerous and active, a cow pad can be buried within the first 24 hours. At this rate of disposal, fly development in the dung will be severely restricted, and the few flies produced will be stunted, short-lived, and incapable of laying many eggs. On the left, fly reproduction has been normal in the pad where beetles were absent, while in this other dish, few have survived the burying activity of the beetles, and those that have are small. Another natural enemy to help control fly populations is the hesterid beetle. This is not a dung-bearing beetle, but feeds directly on the fly larva in the dung pad. No dung pad-adapted hesterids were known to exist in Australia, so this beetle species too had to be imported. Particularly after periods of lean food supplies, hesterids can show extraordinary enthusiasm for their work. North of the Tropic of Capricorn, dung pads are the breeding grounds for the buffalo fly. This is a major pest of livestock in areas such as coastal Queensland, the Northern Territory, and the Kimberley region of Western Australia. Infestations can number thousands on one animal alone. In the past, chemical sprays were used to control the buffalo fly, but their use has now been restricted to avoid problems of chemical residues in animal products. A fly may bite an animal 10 to 12 times a day. This causes extreme restlessness in cattle and can lead to sores around the animal's eyes and lesions of the hide due to the beast's efforts to relieve the irritation. The dung beetle can play a key role in tropical areas by dispersing the buffalo fly's breeding sites. In heavily stocked cattle country, dung lies around wastefully blanketing significant areas of pasture. The amount of dung dropped by one animal in a year can smother and alienate up to 1/10 of an acre of pasture, and there are some 25 million cattle in Australia. Where the pads are left undisturbed, the leaching of concentrated dung nutrients stimulates a rank fringe of grass growth which is unpalatable to cattle and remains ungrazed. Where dung beetles are active, this loss of pasture is avoided and pads are rapidly broken down. Grass growth actually benefits from dung nutrients released and combined with the soil. In the long term, the level of soil nutrients will rise with the continued burial of dung. Three soil samples are sown with Japanese millet seed. In the first pot, the millet plants were grown in soil alone. In the second, dung was allowed to remain undisturbed on the surface, while in the third, beetles were added and allowed to bury dung in the soil. Of course, this was a laboratory experiment, and in the field, such dramatic variations in growth will rarely occur. However, over a period of time, dung beetle activity will substantially increase the availability of the dung nutrients for plant growth. By studying beetle behavior under comparable conditions of soil, climate, and dung types in Africa, and under laboratory trials in Australia, the scientists can select the most promising beetle species from the vast number available in Africa. Releases of dung beetles are being made progressively throughout the chief cattle areas of northern and southern Australia. Field releases are made by officers of the CSIRO's Division of Entomology in cooperation with the State Departments of Agriculture, Farmers, and others with knowledge of the local situation. Release sites are selected where the particular beetle species is most likely to adapt best to the local conditions and multiply and spread rapidly.
Well, if you could give us a bit of an idea, Steve, just where your property is and what paddocks we use.
Yes, the property is situated 4 miles north of Yarra Glen in the valley of the Steeles Creek, valley that consists of some 3,000 acres of land, much of it creek flats and rising hill country.
And there are plenty of cattle in the area?
Yes, it's a predominantly cattle area.
Cooperation of graziers in selecting sites is readily offered and is vital to the success of the program. Aside from the presence of grazing animals, the major considerations in selecting release sites are suitable climate and type of soil. The nature of the soil will affect the beetle's ability to construct soil tunnels. Areas that are subject to regular flooding should be avoided in making the initial releases because of the likelihood of beetles drowning. It has taken us nearly 2 centuries to start putting the missing link back into the ecological chain. While there remain many unknown factors which may affect the success of the beetle program, early results indicate that dung beetles will prove an outstanding example of biological control of immense value to Australia.